Welcome everyone, and thank you so much for joining this Train the Trainer program masterclass and showing your interest in this program. So our today's training and today's masterclass starts with a very recommended tool that kind of everyone is using nowadays, and a lot of people want to learn a lot because there are a lot of possibility in Figma now, and it has started a lot of new features about wireframe, prototype, and a lot of a lot of people are doing the complete UI in this as well. So that's why it has become a very interesting journey for Figma and interesting for the people to know more about Figma. So for this we have Karan Kapoor, who is going to take us through Figma, and it's going to be a 3-week classes for all of you. And it's like every week, 1 hour we'll be having these classes, and Karan will be covering up a lot of very interesting points. I want Karan to tell about those parts, and we're going to covering exactly what are those points, components, and what are all the points he's going to cover. Let him cover that part. So just to introduce Karan, he has been very active on Figma community. I have seen him kind of giving these kind of masterclasses very often, and he has been a very active rethinker on the rethinking UX as well. So that's why we approached him to go through these 3-week classes. We'll be having classes this week. Next week we'll not be having classes, means next weekend we'll not be having classes because of Holi. And after that, next 2 weeks we'll be having our classes. So I request all of you to take part in all 3 classes so that you are kind of in the flow and you understand all the detail of Figma, because this classes have been designed in such a manner that all 3 classes, if you do, you will kind of get a good hand-on expertise in Figma. So with that, I would want to hear from few of you people. I would want few of you people, maybe you can raise your hand. I want to know from you people, like, why exactly do you want to master Figma? Anyone would like to say some word about that? What is your motivation towards knowing more about Figma? I have seen a lot of people writing over there. I want to give option to just one or two people. So I got a hand from Pranav. Pranav, can you please unmute and tell your reason why do you actually want to be and learn more about, about Figma?
So I think primarily it's because the bar for entry or the barrier for entry to most of the tools in design, or maybe I think all across technology, has been lowered so much that everybody can get a false sense of that they know the tool or that they have a expertise over it. And I think that's something I've felt for a long time regarding Figma. I've been using it a lot over the past 6-7 months. But again, I think I am fooling myself to think that I really know it, but I don't really, really know it. So I want to really build a competency or in that and really learn it in the truest sense. I think that's what my motivation was.
Good to know. And I assume that you should be going with a very good answers of your questions, what you are looking for. I expect you to be there for all 3 weeks over here. I can see one more people, Jatin, raising your hand. Would you like to say a few words while you are looking for this? I think this is Sunil Gupta. My mistake. Sunil Gupta raised the hand, right?
Yes. Hello. So yeah. I just want to learn more about Figma. It's like another tool. I just want to learn, and like. Recently, I have faced some issues with the Adobe XD upgrade version. I faced a very typical situation where I lost my file, and these URLs has been shared with the client, and it's a very embarrassing situation. Like they have bookmarked everywhere, and I raised the support to the Adobe XD guys. Surprisingly, they came back after I created another file and I shared it back with the stakeholders and everything. Then they came up and called me. Do you feel still you need any support? I seriously said like, this is very sad situation. And what I'm listening, like Figma is growing much, much further from the Adobe XD. And also it's like, it's not dependent with the software tool. Where we quickly open up in the browser itself and do the things in place straight away. I have also some queries. Like joining these sessions, maybe I will become some expert or something, like I quickly transform to Figma. And the company also discussions are going on, like it's a kind of Adobe XD versus Figma kind of discussions is going. By these sessions, if I get some confident, I can also tell like more content, you can, even it is costly or like whatever it is, I can say my words and do the better thing.
All the best. I think yes, this is very embarrassing when you lose your files, and I hope that you fight for Figma when there's a fight and discussion about XD versus Figma. Let's go for this 3-week course and then let's see how we can do. So yes. So the last person I'm going to call is going to be Ratnakar Gautam. Just say your this program, and then we'll jump to Karen.
Hi folks, I'm Ratnakar this side. Yeah, so basically at first I was using a Sketch for my design tools, but the problem is same as per like Sunil is the guy. Yeah, it's like lots of like thinking about the like files and anything, and the second reason behind it, like we have like required like lots of different type of tools if you are creating wireframing or prototyping, like InVision, JustInMind, Balsamiq, like lots of tools. But Figma has everything. Figma has everything, like if we have to create like wireframing or anything. So that's why I am using Figma. But yeah, I am super excited and interested and so excited to know about like what the future of this Figma, what the like more updation, like our community is also introduced like a Slack in Figma, like we have to like lots of different type of ideas, different type of chips and anything, different type of like resources. So that's why I'm using Figma, and and I'm super excited to see Mayur sir is here. Because in my previous organization, Mayur sir is my senior also in Magic Bricks. Okay. So yeah, I'm super excited to know about
it. Got it. Great to have you here, Ratnakar. And thank you everyone for joining. And that's the fact that Figma has been growing very rapidly, and they are kind of exploring a lot of stuff, new stuff, very rapidly. That is what is making Figma kind of coming in the market as like a superpower right now in terms of wireframe and tools that people of Visual XDMS are using. So without any further delay, I would want that Karan, please take it over from here. Maybe you can share your screen from here, and you can start from here. And for all of you, if you have any query in between, maybe you can just raise your hand, and then I'll pass it to Karan, or Karan will take it forward from there. Let's not jump in with your question directly, so that it should not break the flow of Karan. Let him go through the way he has planned. And if you have any query, please do raise your hand and we'll take it forward.
Sure. Great.
So I'm stopping for them to see. Karan, please share your part.
Sure. I'd just like to introduce myself first. So my name is Karan, and I'm a UX designer based in New Delhi. And I have a good idea of using design tools. I started with Photoshop, Illustrator. So all that knowledge combined to make me a better Figma user. Or I used Sketch in my organization in my first job. I used to use Adobe XD, where I had learned how to animate using auto animate. And then in Sketch, I learned how to create design systems. So when I moved to freelancing, I am a Windows user, so I didn't get to use Sketch as much, or not at all. So I was looking for an alternate because it was getting really hard for me to maintain or create a design system in Adobe XD, and that is where Figma came in. I just went ahead and started using it. So that is how I started using it, and it's been a year almost. And as soon as I started using, I thought that a lot more people should know about it and how to make best use of it. So that is why I started conducting these online sessions. I might have conducted 40 odd sessions last year, and this year I'm just starting out. So yeah, you can expect more sessions, and with Friends of Figma Delhi, which I kind of am the advocate for. So yeah, without further ado, I would just like to share my screen and present what I have for today, so that we can get started with the agenda. So today's today's session I have planned in a way that you get to know about some tricks, you get to know about some hidden, some things that you might not know about. You can, I'm not sure if you know about them or not, but I have seen a lot of people not use those things. I will be starting with that, and styles and components are what I will be talking about most today. If you can, yeah, if you can see my screen, let me know. If you cannot, just let me know in that case.
Yes, we can, Karan.
Okay, sure, great. So, some of my videos are on YouTube as well. You can go and check it out. You can type Karan Kapoor Filma and my channel will be there. And Instagram is Karan Kapoor UX at any. And you can see that I have created this background, which is one of the new features that is called interactive components. And this is one of the interactive components in the background. You can see the red moving in circles. And that is just one component, and that I have replicated all over my slide. So as to keep people engaged during the presentation and also have some interactive element in the presentation. Okay, great. So the first thing that I would like to address is that you should now, a lot of people have been using Photoshop, Adobe XD, Sketch. So in that, the default way to combine different elements is a group. But in Figma, that is not the case, because a group is different than a frame. So what a group is, it is just a combination of, it is not a container, it is a combination. So Figma has differentiated both of these things in a way that both of these things have a different use for them. So I'll show you how and why you should use a frame and what are the advantages of using it over a group. So a lot of us have this shortcut in mind that whenever we want to combine two or three objects, we just use Control and G or Command or G on Mac, right? But I would want you all to have a change in your approach. So Figma has a frame, which is very, very powerful. A frame can act as a phone screen, it can act as an overlay, it can act as a container, it can act as multiple other things, and you can nest them as well. So a frame can be inside a frame, and then you can make use of auto layout only on a frame, not on a group. So that is what I will tell you about, and I will show you why you should use a frame instead of a group. And the shortcut you should keep in mind is Control Alt G or Command Option G. Alright. So let me just demonstrate what I mean by that. I'll just type in some text. So this is my text, and say I have a subtext as well. Okay, I'll just give it a smaller size. Okay, so, and now I will combine this as a group first. So Control and G. Okay, so you can see this is the icon, or this is the denotion of a group. You can see it here as well. And then I will just duplicate it. I'm duplicating it by holding the Alt or Option key and dragging it by mouse. And at any time, if you feel that you don't know something or you might need to ask something, just feel free to raise your hand. I'll be happy to help, because these are some of the features that might not cover the basics, right? So here is my group and here is my frame. Okay, so I'll just convert it to a frame from here. It is that easy in Figma. Okay, so what are the challenges in a group? Okay, I'll just show you those challenges. So if I expand these frames and group, you will be able to see that I'm able to set constraints. So constraint is where I want the element to be stick to when I increase or decrease the size of this frame. So you can see that it is relevantly easy. And when I use a group, you see that it gets jumbled whenever I want to make any changes. It doesn't maintain spacing, and I'm not able to maintain the size of these different elements, right? So if I just shrink it, you'll be able to see that these point values are introduced inside the height, which is not ideal when you have to work on large files, or when you have to work on screens which involve a lot of components. Groups are not the ideal way to do it. You can use a frame. So you see that whenever I'm doing this, it is not altering the height of my elements inside. Okay, and it is also sticking to the right points. Okay, so if I give it a constraint that it should stick to the right and it should stick to the top, and this one should stick to the right and to the bottom. So whenever I increase the frame size, you can see it, they will stick to their respective constraints, right? So that is the required behavior here. And when I use a group, I'll not be able to set any constraints. So in Adobe XD and in sketch, you are able to do that inside a group as well, but inside Figma you are not able to do that. And the hack for doing that is just go here and change it to a frame, and then your life will feel better, and you'll be able to do a lot more with frames. And also, when your frame is of a smaller size, you can set the content to clip content, right? So what clip content means is that whatever the content inside the frame is. So let me just make a rectangle, and I have seen a lot of people do this as well, that they create a rectangle, they add text on top of it, and then they group it. So that is not the ideal way to be used in how you should do it in Figma, because frame is the ideal container in Figma, right? So I would highly recommend every one of you to try this approach, that instead of pressing Control G or Command G, you can shift it to Command Option G or Control Option G. So this is a rectangle inside my frame, and if I want that, whenever I decrease the size of this frame, I want only this much area to be shown. So I can just click on clip content, and the rectangle would still be there, but it will not be shown. All right. So this is an approach that I would like everyone to follow in Figma, because it is a very scalable approach. Frames are very scalable, and this can even be opened as an overlay, which is different in different software. So yeah, this is a pro tip that I would like to share. And instead of a group, just move it to a frame. It's not very hard. Just whenever you have a group, just convert it to a frame or vice versa, right? And inside a frame, I would like to tell you that you don't even need a rectangle, which is in a frame, you can just add a background to the frame itself. So this is a frame. I've added a background. I would not need to adjust the rectangle size every time I increase or decrease the size of this container, because the frame is the default background or default container, which we had to create a rectangle for otherwise. So this is the first tip, this is the first hack, or this is the first pro tip that I want every one of you to know, so that you can be sure of the pixel perfect design that everyone looks for. That if I use a group, otherwise you will not be able to see pixel perfect design. So it has already jumbled my design, design elements, width, and it has come in points, and everyone, no one likes that. And developers also face a problem when they look at such designs which have a point mark in their elements and things like that. So this is how you can change that approach, and this is a very scalable approach as well. So yeah, this is the first thing. Anyone has any questions, so just let me know, and you can raise your hand. I'll be happy to help you out.
I can see Sunil Gupta has raised the hand. Is it regarding this only, Sunil?
Yeah, I mean, just trying to understand when all the purpose, like you said, right, in the sketch and the Adobe XD group has the same features. Why Figma has differentiated two things, like a group and again this frame?
Okay, this has a lot of context. Right? So first, that a frame can be used as individual entity, right? Whereas a group needs a frame to be. So I'll just show you what I mean by that. So this is a presentation that I made, right? You can see this. And when I come to the presentation screen, if I change it to a frame, to a group, you won't be able to see that in my presentation. Why? Because a frame is a separate entity. It is a container in Figma. In other software, that is a group. But in Figma, a frame is a container which can be used as an overlay when you have. So you don't need to create that back one. You don't need to create two screens and then create overlay with opacity, black color opacity, and then add elements over it. You can just attach that overlay to that screen, and that would open as a separate entity. So that is why frames and groups are different, because frame can act as an individual element, whereas a group needs a frame to be inside. This is a differentiator that Figma has made, because a phone screen and an overlay, a pop-up, a dialog box screen are both the same now, and they can be opened from one another. So this is kind of a problem solving approach that they took when they thought that people are facing issue with making overlays and having certain repeatable elements inside groups, so they decided to make that shift. So that is what my understanding is, but it is a very powerful feature, so that is why I kind of recommend it to everyone.
Sure, Karan. And don't mind, like I day and night I was been on Adobe XD, and as it is new thing, like I might ask questions and
sure. No problem with that. So this is why.
Yeah. So thanks, Karan. These are the great tips to begin with. Tell me. So I have been like using shortcut K to transform the groups, and it has worked fine. So what is the difference here now? You have said frame group, and I have a shortcut K.
Shortcut K.
Yes. So if I press K even in the group, it does the same work.
Let me just see. So K, okay. So I'll just explain why. So K is for scaling up.
Yeah.
This is where I think you are coming from. Is for scaling up, right? Yeah. So scaling up, if I scale this up, this is a group. If I scale this up, then it might introduce these point elements, which are not very ideal. So if I reduce it, you can see that points have already been introduced. And when we are using, when we are creating designs, we want that it should have, so I'll just put it in some context.
No, I get it. Yeah.
So it introduces points, and a group is not a container. So container is a different entity in Figma, and container is very powerful, which is a frame. So of a mobile screen, which is this. So this is a mobile screen. This is a frame, and this is a container, right? And I can change this frame to an iPad mini very easily, and all the constraints will be respected. So I wanted it to stick to the top and right, and here I wanted it to stick to the bottom and right, and that is what it has obeyed. So no matter what I make it, it will obey those things. Yeah. And in groups, you cannot do that. You don't have that flexibility. So when you stretch it, you cannot apply constraints. So it has increased in size, whereas we want the text to be in the same height or the same line height that we have attached to it. So that is why I would recommend this.
Yeah, thanks, Dan.
Yeah. So this is something that a lot of people don't know. I have seen a lot of people, observed them, looked at different files that people have shared with me. So I thought this might be a good point to start. Right. So the next thing that I have is that if you have some properties attached to, say, a rectangle, a frame, or anything in general, or text, and you want to copy that to another, you know, another text or another element, another rectangle, another frame for that matter, you can do it very easily. So the long way is to right click on it, go to the properties, copy paste, and click on copy properties, go to the next element and right click and click on paste properties. And that is how the properties can be shifted from one element to the other. The other way is by using the shortcut that is mentioned in the drop down, which is Control Option Command Option V, or Control Alt V and Control Alt C. So copy properties and paste properties has this shortcut. I'll just show you how that works. So for example, I have this frame. I want that this iPhone frame should have the same background, right? It should have the same background, even if it has a different size. Then I want that to have the same background. So instead of going here, then clicking on I, copying this from the eyedropper, what I want is, so if you have textile, this works very well when you have color styles, defined. So I click on this frame, I click on this color style, I attach a different color style. I'll also explain why I'm going into that, and say this is the text color, right? I also introduce this text here in this frame, and I give it a black color, okay? And when, so this is a text style, I would also show if it doesn't have a text style, right? I am detaching the color style from here. So I will click on this frame and use the shortcut Control Alt C, which is copy properties, and then go to this frame and click on Control Alt V. And this is how I have very easily transported, or, you know, copied the styles of this particular frame or this particular element to a frame, or to any other object for that matter. If I click on this text, and if I then go to copy paste and copy properties, and then I go here and click on paste properties, it will have the same properties that this text has, which the similar properties get copied and the non-similar properties don't get copied. So a text has properties like size, line height, font weight, font, which are not relevant to a frame or a container, but it has the property of color as common, so that has transported or that has been copied to the frame that I have. This is a very quick way to, you know, transport properties between different elements, different types of elements, same type of elements, and also save you time. So if you have a color style attached to this text, say this is the color style, color gray 800, and if I also have a text style attached to it, which is this, so I don't want to go here, then attach a color style, look for it, and then attach a text style, look for it. What I'll do is I'll just press Control Alt C, which is copy, and then click here and click on Control Alt V. So all the properties from this text have come to this text and with attached color and text styles. So this is how, this is a very quick that you can take to your daily designs, that if you want to copy it from one element to other, then you can use this shortcut and save time when you have a lot of, so if someone comes to you and says that this doesn't work, we need to change this, or we need to change it across all the styles, if you don't have styles defined, then this trick would come in very handy to you. Any questions, just let me know, I'll be happy to help you. Otherwise I'll move forward.
I can see Pooja Arora raising her hand. Is it regarding this or something else, Pooja?
I just have one question regarding frames. Is it okay to use multiple frames inside one frame, means as many as we want?
Yeah, you can use even 1,000 frames inside a frame, because auto layout has that. Auto layout is also a frame, and nesting of auto layouts is where, you know, the expertise of someone comes in. That I have created one whole page with multiple nesting of auto layouts and it works fine, and that is a scalable approach as well. Instead of using groups, you can nest as many frames as you want, and it is a very fast container also. I mean, it will save you some space in the screen, I mean loading times and screen sizes, so, and also not have you care about things like what if the point values are introduced or things like that. So yeah, use as many of them as you want.
And are we also covering auto layout in these sessions?
I will try to cover some of it, but that is, I did two videos on it two weeks ago. I'll post them. So that was with friends of Figma. I'll post them on some platform and I'll let you know. But I'll try to cover as much as I can, but because that is a very huge topic.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. So this is a second tip, or this is a second trick that you can use to kind of supercharge your workflow. And the next one is something that
Karan, I think Swati has a question. She raised the hand.
Okay.
To ask a question.
Hi, Karan.
Yeah, hi.
Sometimes Conan try to compile.
Your voice is breaking, Swati.
It's fine now.
No, not really.
Swati, can you drop it on the chat window, yeah, so that Karan can take it up next time?
Sure.
Okay, so the next thing that I have seen a lot of people talk about these things but not use them as much in their designs, which is creating text styles and color styles. So how you can create it is very easy. Whenever you use a color or a text, so if I have defined this text and if I have defined this text, what I can do is I can define it as a text style and then go very easily to, you know, copy this text style and create a scalable system for myself. So I would just need to click over here and define it as a text style. Okay, text slash whatever the naming convention I'm using, I'm not going deep into that. Text slash medium So I use this convention. I use number 100 by multiples of 100 with each increasing text size. And also you can define a color style. So if this is a color, I can define a color style, color slash black. Okay, so for example, this is the color. And if I want to go to some other text and very quickly apply these styles, what I can do is I can either use the shortcut that I told you about, Control Alt C, Control Alt V, or if I kind of don't know the shortcut, I can go in here and I can search for the size that I defined and then also search for the color that I defined. So this is how you can use text styles and color styles and combine them to create different elements, have them applied to different backgrounds. But what if you don't know how to use this approach yet, or you are not sure of how to create color styles, how to create text styles, and go about creating this system wherein you have text, you have color, and you have color defined in various categories. So my next point is around that, and there is a plugin that I would like to mention here, and the plugin name is Styler. Okay, so I'll tell you where this plugin comes in and how you can use it for your own benefit. This is a plugin, I'll drop its link in the chat. Okay. So this is a plugin, and I'll tell you now where it kind of comes in. Right, so if you go to Figma community and then you go to files, right, say you don't have a search query here, right, if I go to Figma community in general, and if I click on design systems, right, and I am exploring design systems, and I stumble upon one of the design systems that I really like, or if I would like to replicate its colors or replicate its text styles in my own designs as well. So this is a very popular Figma file, or this is a very popular system where Tailwind CSS UI, this is also used in web. So if you want to very quickly copy these styles, so instead of copying each one of them and defining them as a color style, copying each one of them, defining all the properties like line height, like font size and things like that, you don't want to go into that hassle. So what do you do then? That is where this plugin, which is Styler plugin, comes in. I'll just show you. I think I have this file copied. Yeah, this is my file. I already duplicated it, so I didn't have to do for this session. So I come here, I realize that these are some really good colors and I can benefit from these colors and benefit from this textile as well, these textiles or this typography system as well. What I do is I go on to create a new page, right click, go to plugins, go to the Styler plugin and click on simply extract styles. So what it will do is it will extract all the styles that are used in this file. So these are all the colors with their names, so gray 400, gray 500, and all the text styles with their names, right? You can also do it yourself. You can define a text, you can define a text style, whatever the hierarchy you want, and give it the name of the text style that you want to define it as. So for example, this is the size that I want to define as text SM medium, okay? I just name this layer as text SM medium, and then I will show you how to create styles out of it. And I want to pick it up for my own file. I just copy all of these, Control A, copy, go on to my own file, which is this file, paste it here, right? And then right click here and click on Styler plugin and then click on Generate Styles. What will happen is all the styles that are here, all the styles that I've attached over here will be automatically created in my file, so that I don't have to go through the hassle of defining one color style, one text style at a time, and save time as well. So these are quite a lot of styles, that is why it is taking time. But if you have less, so yeah. Now you can see on the right hand side, it is still running. Yeah, so on the right hand side, you can see all the colors, so you can just close them. These are a lot of colors, I didn't realize. And you can close them, and when you want to design your own UI, you can use this as the baseline, or you can use this for experimentation or for learning purpose as well, that you don't know a lot about textiles, you don't know a lot about color style, so you use it from some other file. So for example, this is a file that I have made, right? And I would just undo it from here so the file doesn't get heavy. This is a file that I have made, Evolve Component Library. This is in Figma community as well. If you want, if you like the colors on this file, so if you say you want to use these colors in your design as well, and these textiles as well, go ahead, copy this file, come on to this file, go to the styler plugin, click on extract styles. Whatever styles are in my file, you will see them. Copy it to your own file and then just create. I will just paste them here. Yeah, just be careful where to paste them. And right click here and click on styler, generate style. So in no time, you will have all the styles that I've used in my file. And one good thing about this is that this is a common repository. You can create it as many times as you want. And when you want to edit it, say you don't want this character spacing between these at 18 points, okay, 18 pixels. So you just increase the character spacing, right click here, and then go to plugin, and then click on generate style. So it updates the already created instance of that textile everywhere. So this, you can create one page for this so that you have a centralized repository and you come here every time you want to edit it. And you just have to edit it, click right click on it, make sure that the layer name is correct, and then click on generate styles, and it would change everywhere that you have defined. So this is a very quick example of when you want to not spend a lot of time. If you have different files, or if you have two files where you want to, one you want to share with the client and the other one you want to keep for yourself, you can have the same styles and then just attach the same styles back when you copy it to the other file, so that you don't lose time in that aspect. Yeah, this was another tip that I wanted to share regarding styles. Any questions around that? Has anyone raised their hand? Alok, can you let me know?
No one so far. I think Swati had written her question, what she okay. to ask. She couldn't speak. Maybe let me read it for you. When I try to copy and paste a component on the frame, sometimes it pastes outside the frame. Yes, what could be the reason for it? Any easy way to drag it in the desired frame? Because I always end up and searching the frames from left nav.
Okay. Yeah, very great trick is that just click on the frame name when you have to do that. So if I delete it from here, if I want to copy it here, I can paste it here, but it won't go into this frame. If you want to paste it inside the frame, just click on the frame name, okay, frame 2, and just paste it so that it is inside the frame. That is, I think that is what you wanted to know, and this is how you can do it. A lot of people face issue with that, and if you want to move it inside the frame, you fear that it will go outside the frame, start moving it and then hold the space bar so that it stays inside the frame no matter where you take it. Even if it is out of your view, it will stay inside that frame. That is something you can keep in mind. Great. And the next thing, yeah.
Anything? Yeah, I think there's there's no raised hand. Maybe we can move. Oh, I think Sunil Gupta raised the hand. Is it regarding yes, Sunil?
Yeah, so regarding the style side, the style. Yeah, Karan, I have a different question about this style guide. I just want to have some justification. Yeah, definitely it's a very great thing to have these plugins. I just want to know, let's say I have a situation where you have a crucial time and you are creating a huge application. But again, you need to create your own style and hand over to the developer team. Okay? But you are not in a situation to how to arrive the styles and all properly manage these things. And these plugins will definitely help to understand where to start and where to end. That will definitely help. But the situation is like, let's say if we import these plugins, let's say the plugins have top to bottom each and every items, like from core element to the element to elements. Like, let's say there are plugin have the 100 items, but I don't need in all together items, like how can you handle that situation? Like, let's say I need only like 30 items of that plugin, and again I need to spend my time to dig deeper into the plugin styles available there, and I need to map my styles according to the application and what my requirement needs. Is there a way, quick thing to overcome the turnaround time? Is there any point you can suggest this?
I can't think of any. Sorry, I didn't get it 100% your question, but I'll get back to you if I have anything on that. I think I need to think about that a bit more.
No issues.
Okay, thank you. So this is a plugin that can help you to save time and even learn about how to use styles. And that is, the styles are the foundation of, you know, scalable designs or creating components for that matter. And the second next thing that I have is exactly that, which is components. I hope some of you might know about components, and I mean a lot of you might be using them in your organization as well. But there are some new things recently announced with respect to components. I'd not go very deep into how to create a component and how to use it at different places. It's very easy. You can, if you have a component library defined, or if you have some components defined, then you can go into say creating a page, creating a screen, for example iPhone 11, and then you can drag and drop the components over here. I'll not go into how to do that because that would take a lot of time. But if you have, say, this component, and if you want to easily switch between, say, which is the active tab, I want the second one to be active, I want the third one to be active, I don't want three tabs, I want two tabs. So how do you go about making that scalable, making one component that scalable? Because in development, that is how it works. It is very scalable. A component can be switched very easily with just adding one or two more properties. That is what Figma has kind of replicated. Okay, so I'll show you how to do that. So if you define one component, say this is the navbar, I'll copy it to a different file. This file I'll copy it to. And this is a navbar, right? So I'll just name it navbar. And this is my navbar. And there are some things I want to edit whenever I want to, you know, change some things in it. I'll just duplicate it once and then click on Command D or Control D to create a duplicate of it. And I want this tab to be active now. So I'll just click here. So the color is gray. I would just change the color over here. So this is my active tab now. And here I will change the color to gray so that I can have some differentiation between all these components. Okay. This is the blue color, and in, so the third tab is active, the second tab is active, and in here the first tab is active, right? I would just change the color over here to blue, right, and change this to gray. Where is gray? Too many colors. I don't think this is the right gray, but okay. And now I want to easily switch between these components whenever I use this component. So this component navbar can be an encapsulation of which tab is active and can be easily switched between, right? So how do you go about that? So when you have created a duplicate, these are instances, right? So I will first detach these instances, right click, detach instance, and then select them again and then create a component out of them again. Create multiple components, otherwise both of them will be combined in one component, right? So now what I will do is I will select all of these three, and this is a new thing that you will see on the right hand side, which is variants. Okay, I will just combine them as variants. So what happened is that the navbar component contains all of these three, right? And there has to be a mechanism to switch between these three wherever I use it. So for example, you are making three tabs, right? And you want that in the first screen, I want this to be active. Second screen, this to be active. Third screen, this to be active, right? So you won't go in every time and then adjust the color and adjust everything related to that third element or whatever element you want to make active, right? So to save time on that end, what you can do is you can structure them like this. go to its definition, which is the frame navbar, right? And then come on the right hand side, which is where the meat of things happen. Right? You have property one. So property one, I can call it active frame, active tab. And then here I can add, if I go into each of these individually, active tab, this can be 3, this can be 2, and then this can be 1. Okay. So whenever I use it in design, so I will create a new page and use the iPhone frame. Okay. I click on A, which is to call the frames. I'll click on A, search for navbar in my assets. Right, drag and drop it in my frame. And if I have 3 screens, 1, 2, and 3, I want the second to be active here. Instead of going here, changing the color style and doing everything in that respect, I just go here, which is my definition of a component. Click on second, and here I click on first. So this is how you can easily switch between the different states of these components. And this is not only limited to, say, changing which tab is active. It can also, you can also add a logic of active, inactive, and that is what I'm going to show you now, right? And any questions around this, just let me know, right? And I would just like to show you what other aspect you can use in it. So for example, if you have, so this is a radio, this is a switch that I created, this is a concept switch that I created, right? I will copy it here inside the page that I had made. Just a second. Yeah, I will copy it here. So you can see this switch has, so I will just delete it from here for now. This is the no logic, okay? And then I will also add yes logic, okay? So this is where I would add yes logic, add a green color to it, remove color from here. Right, so that it looks inactive, remove color from here as well, and then change these to some other color, say this color, and change this to a white color. Okay, change this to a white color as well. So you can see I'm not even defining anything at this point. I'm just clicking on the text style and the color style, and then going about making changes. So this is again a variant of it. So I'll detach it first, create a component out of it, right? So I will just name it switch. I will name both of these switch for now so that I can explain you how the logic would work. Right, these are two variants of the switch. Select both of them, click on combine as variants, and then attach a property. In this one, I will attach a property of yes. Okay. So why I have done that, I will show you in just a second. You go on to individual component. So this is no, so you can type in false. Okay, you can type in false here, and then go here, you can type in true here. Okay, so what it means is that this property, when yes property is true, this will be active, and when the yes property is false, this will be active. I'll show you how to use it. You go on to your page. If you want to use that component, you search for it. Switch, so it encapsulates both of the components, which is yes and no. And you see, I added a true or true and false, and that is why I have a switch here. So I can very easily switch between these two elements when I want to use it in my design. So if I want that in some screen, I want to show yes, so I can just go on and just switch it from here. So this is a switch logic. You can make a lot of people can make games out of it as well. You can make any sort of games. You can make a cross and zeros and cross and a lot of things that are not only limited to UI design. So this is how you can use this variants feature in Figma with components. This only works with components too, if you would want to know more about it. Yeah, any questions around it, just let me know.
Ooh. I think I can see Pranav and Rasika raising their hand. Pranav would like to go ahead first.
Sure.
It might have been a mistake. I don't have it raised.
Oh, okay. No worry.
Okay.
Rasika, do you have a question? Rasika is there or? Looks like she dropped off. I think maybe we can go ahead.
Okay. Okay, great. Yeah, and thing is laid on top of that, wherein you can create one component. And the problem that we all face is that we want to show different states to developers, right? We want to show that this is the active state, this is what will happen when we hover over it, and this is what will happen when we kind of it is in a disabled state or an inactive state. So you can see I have defined a button, and these are all the properties I've linked to it. Okay, so you might need to explore it a bit more. So this is my button style. And these are all the buttons that I've used in the design library. And I've added a logic to access all of these, right? But what I will do is, when I have to access this button, I will just search for button over here, drag and drop it, and all the buttons are encapsulated in this one button. With small change in, you know, I can change these properties and get to the other style of button very quickly. If I want an icon or not, if I want the press state, the disabled state, the primary button, small size, large size. So this you will have to explore a bit more, but if you explore it, you'll not go back to the conventional ways of having 50 components and changing them one by one when you do that. And one more thing inside this button as well, I have used a text style so that I'm not dependent on, you know, editing this text style whenever I decide to change in this text style or change my typography system altogether. Right, so this is a very quick tip on how to use variants. The next thing is laid on top of that.
Karan, yeah. When you change the size of this component, does it remain same or does that change? Like if I change the size of this button, what about the font size and all? Do I need to define that again or will that take care itself?
So you need to define all of that once. Okay, so I have defined all of these once. Yeah. In this, say for example, in this 14 is the size, and in this, say a smaller button, the 12 is the size, right? And then you define all of these ones, and then you combine them and think of some logic to make them as one variant, and everything can be accessed from them. And one more great thing which a lot of people were talking about, all of these buttons is an auto layout, so creating another style of button from one style is very easy. So this is the right. So icon on this is on the left side. I can just click on this element, push it to the left without making any kind of manual maneuvers. Okay, so auto layout makes it very easy in that case. And yeah, that is how these buttons are laid out.
That's awesome.
I'll just share the link of this file if someone wants to use it. I created it.
Yeah, that would be helpful for everyone to refer to at least.
Yeah, I created it for people who are just starting out to learn about components, design libraries, design systems, so that they can also learn about it and use it in practice. Yeah. I just drop a link to this file.
Yeah, you can share that link or the Ask channel, Ask Question sure, channel sure. In the Slack. That would be
sure. I'm dropping it here as well if anyone wants to use it or. And the next and the last thing for today is the variant. Oh, sorry. This is not variant. This is interactive components. This is a new feature that was recently announced. Some of you might have it because you signed up for it. I have signed up for it. That is why I got it in beta. Because it is in beta right now, not a lot of you might be able to access it. Okay. So whenever you get access to it, if you still have access, I'll show you how to use it and how it solves some problem in our daily lives, right? For example, this is my radio button, okay? And I want that when I hand it over to, say, some marketing team or any other team which doesn't have a lot of hands-on experience with design, they would want to see how we can interact with this screen, right? So what you have to simply do is, if you have, I have these defined radio button defined as variant, okay? The same logic, the true-false logic that I told you about, here I have. So if I want this component to be in an on state, I just have it at true, and when I want to have it in off state, I have the on property as false. Okay, and if I want this to be an interactive component, what I can do is, so I just click on this. So this is a frame. That is why I'm also able to add a prototype. So another thing with frames is that you can create prototypes or you can link different frames to it. With a group, that is not possible, right? So I'll just drag out my arrow from this variant to another variant and choose this property, which is a new property here, change to, okay? And then change the animation to smart animate and define a time with it as well. So what happens here is that earlier what we'd have to do is to show the different states and different interactive states of one particular component, we had to create multiple screens. And yeah, I would just show you here how we had to do it earlier. So this is one state, and in this one I had have to change it to on state so that I can show that on clicking this, this is the frame that appears, and I had to create a different screen altogether for that. But with this property, with this variant, with interactive components feature, I can very easily use this, right? I will just show you how it kind of fits in our daily design life. Okay, so for this, if say this is a hypothetical design, okay, this is a hypothetical design that I made, wherein I want to make one of these active every time I click on one of these, right? And then if I click on it again, it needs to be inactive, right? So what you'd have to do in that case is you'd have to refer to the 10th class books, read permutation combination, 11th, 12th class books, read permutation combination, and then create as many screens as the result that you get, and make one of these active, make one of these inactive on one of those screens. But with this interactive component feature, you don't have to do that. It is very easy. And I'll show you, I'll also link the active state back to the inactive state, where I click on it and it goes back to the inactive state. So I'll just show you in prototype how it works, right? This is my screen. I click on click on present. And when I come here, I will be able to interact with them. So if you want, then you can also play games with this. You can create all sorts of different games. So there's a designer by the name of Pablo. He created a game. So I'll just show you. I'll just create a small game out of it. Okay. And you can also use it. So instead of click, I will choose the hover option. Okay. On click, I'm choosing on hover. And also here I will choose while hovering. Okay, so now let's see what happens. So you can see this is how it's. I will need to adjust the time a bit, right? So adjust the time a bit more, right? And then when you come over here, you can see that how I am able to hover on all of these, and then very easily, and very I don't know, this is something I haven't done before this, so this is kind of new for me. But you can play small games, you can create small things on this as well. And yeah, this is how you can do it. So this was the last thing that I had to cover today. If you have any questions related to anything, please feel free to unmute yourself, raise your hand and ask me. I would be happy to help you.
Hey, Karan, this was awesome. I think I think 50-60% of them were new, at least to me, because I don't play around with Figma. That's not my job like nowadays. But I'm sure we never knew that today there is India versus England T20 match, and they have already played 6-7 overs by now. Looking at the time, but this session session was worth like watching that T20 match. Thanks a lot.
Go on. Yeah, I think a few hands. I see a few hands raised. Yeah, Bhavika, if you have a question, please unmute yourself. Is it Bhavika or is it Manjari? I'm sorry.
Manjari is there. Manjari.
Okay. Sorry.
Hi, Karan. And
hi.
I don't have a question, but yes, I really want to thank you for taking this session in a very patient and an engaging manner.
Thank you.
So I'm not new to Figma, but yes, I'm not pro at it either. Especially the last two sections that you covered, the variants and the interaction part, that was something I was always marveled to learn. And I'm glad that I attended this session and got to know about it in a very less time.
Yeah. I mean, if you explore it, you'll be surprised yourself. So yeah, that is how I learned it myself.
Yeah, that's again a huge thanks for having this session.
Thank you so much. Next time I'll try to keep the content a bit concise and have some of you on the file as well. But I wanted to cover this so that we can proceed to the further sessions and those become easy. Yeah. Any questions from anyone? I'd be happy to help out.
So Karan, it'll be great if you can throw some light on what to expect next week so that others can come prepared with the question, or they can work early on those topics, and then if they have any queries, they can raise them sure. In the next week.
Sure. So next week I would ideally expect people to explore some explore components and how to create that, because next week is going to be about animation, prototyping, and these are the basics of those things, that how when I have to animate something, then interactive components will come in very handy, because I can use it endlessly, right? I can switch between these three very easily, and I can also show you that if I have these tabs, I can switch between them very easily using the variant feature and combining that with the interactive components feature, right? So if I just attach it to here, and then attach it here, and then attach it back, attach this back as well. So there are endless combinations that you can. So here you can see I am able to switch between these tabs very easily. And basically just try to play around with it, create some interactive components, create some variants, and add some logic, some complex logic, such as four properties, I would say. So in the button field, I have size property, I have category, I have state, I have icon on left and right. So these are some things that I would want people to experiment with. And next week we can just dive deep into animating and prototyping with these things in mind, with components, interactive components, variants, so that we can just plug and play everything, and we save time and we learn more about animation. And some tips and tricks is what I have one session planned on. So that would be interesting. So this is what I think people can expect next week or in the coming two or three weeks that we have.
So Karan, I was about to drop the link that you have shared in the chat, but then I stopped. One last favor, if you can drop the link on the Slack channel and give a glimpse what you covered today. And and what others can expect, so that it can also be a help for like others, what they missed today, which they can find from this Figma file, and what they can get out of next week. So that will be a great help, because these master classes and these sessions, these also need some kind of motivation for others, because every time when we do master class or any kind of session, we make sure that it has its own flavor or a touch. So if you drop, it should come from the author itself. So if you drop it, I think it will have its own value.
Right. I'll publish it. I'll make it sure. Open on the community, and then I'll drop a link for this deck that I shared today.
Thanks a lot, Karan.
Also, guys, because we are not available next week, we are not doing because of Holi. So you'll have kind of 2 weeks to maybe practice more about components and all. So when we meet next weekend, you will have an option to showcase your work. If you have explored more about components, we'll spend initial 5 to 10 minutes. If you have worked on something, if you want to showcase to Karan or everyone, we would love to see what you have kind of explored.
If anyone wants to learn about components, I have a lot of videos on YouTube. I covered a lot of these things as well, but interactive components and variants are somewhat new, and I haven't been active since these were launched. So you can go back to some of these videos and learn more about it.